Hi, everyone. Welcome. I'm Nicole Ozer. I'm the Technology and Civil Liberties Policy Director at the ACLU of Northern California and the co-chair of the California State Bar Cyberspace Committee. And it's really my pleasure to welcome you to tonight's program, From Public Squares to Platforms, Free Speech, and the Network World. And the special evening reception and panel is co-sponsored by the State Bar Cyberspace Committee. And for those not familiar with the committee, we are a standing committee of the business law section of the California State Bar. And our mission is really to educate those in the bar. Oh, I think Phil has his mic for him. Our mission is to make a lot of noise about cyberspace law. And to educate members of the bar and the public about emerging issues. So this is one of two events that we sponsored this year, one at the University of Southern California Law School and one here at Stanford on these emerging issues. And so for those of you who are members of the bar, we encourage you when your bar slips come in the mail to check the section for the business law section and join the section. For those of you who are students, it's actually free for students to join any of the sections of the California State Bar, and so we encourage you to become a part of that. And for anyone who'd like to get updates about activities of the committee, our monthly teleconferences, other kinds of events that we're having, I'm going to be circulating a sign-up sheet to get updates from the Cyberspace Committee. If you'd like to get updates, whether you're a lawyer or not, you're welcome to sign up. Or if you are a member of the bar, you can modify your profile on the State Bar website, very cyberspace-like, to ask for those updates. So we'll circulate those. And without further ado, I really want to introduce a really stellar panel for tonight, and I'm just very excited that all of them were able and willing to participate in tonight's event. Right next to me is Dorothy Chou. Dorothy is a senior policy analyst at Google, and she leads Google's policy efforts to increase transparency, which is an ideal part of tonight's topic. She manages the day-to-day operations of the Central Public Policy Team at Google's headquarters just down the way in Mountain View. And Dorothy actually started her work for Google in the Washington, D.C. office 4 years ago, managing issues around China, free expression, and child safety. So I'm sure she didn't have any late nights at Google working on those issues. And Dorothy has a BS in international politics from Georgetown University's Walsh School of Foreign Service. So thank you very much, Dorothy, for joining us. Next to Dorothy, we have Lawrence Pulgrim, who I've had the pleasure to work with quite a bit over the years at the ACLU.
It was my pleasure.
And Lawrence is a partner in the litigation and intellectual property groups of Fenwick and West, which many of us know very well, and chair of its commercial and copyright litigation group. Lawrence's practice really emphasizes technology-related litigation and frequently involves very novel legal issues generated by these information technologies. Next to Lawrence is my colleague, Linda Lai. Linda's a staff attorney at the ACLU of Northern California. She joined the organization last year after serving for 5 years on our board of directors and 7 years on our legal committee. So that is some major service to the ACLU. Linda was formerly a partner at Altshuler Burzon, a San Francisco law firm specializing in labor, employment, and constitutional rights. And early in her career, Linda clerked for both Judge Guido Calabresi of the United States Court of Appeals for the Second Circuit and Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg of the United States Supreme Court. So she really doesn't have any experience in these issues. And Linda graduated from Yale and has a JD from Bolt Hall. Next to Linda is Andrew McLaughlin, who is a self-described tech law and policy nerd.
I don't think I'm the only one who describes me as a huge nerd. But.
And he's a non-residential fellow here at the Stanford Center for Internet and Society and the executive director of Civic Commons, which is a new nonprofit that's helping cities and other governments share and implement low-cost technologies to improve public service management, transparency, and citizen engagement. And he's also a director for Code for America. And last but very certainly not least is Phil Hammer, who's of counsel to the law firm of Hoag Fenton in San Jose. Phil began his legal career as a staff attorney for the U.S. Commission on Civil Rights in Washington, D.C., and then returned to his hometown of San Jose, and for decades has been a leader in family law. Phil will tell you a little bit more in a few minutes about how this all came about, but Phil also successfully litigated the right to circulate petitions in privately owned shopping centers, both in the California Supreme Court in 1979 and all the way up to the United States Supreme Court in 1980 in the seminal First Amendment and California free speech case, Pruneyard Shopping Center versus Robbins. So, he, as an ACLU lawyer, he's certainly a personal hero of mine in this area. And Phil is a graduate of Stanford University, a long-term Stanford University women's basketball booster. But he did receive his Bolt Hall at my alma mater and Linda's Bolt Hall. So go Bears.
Exactly.
So with that, we've got just an amazing panel of speakers tonight. We're going to cover as many issues as we can on sort of what's really happening in this space as speech moves from the public squares to platforms and sort of all the nuances and issues related to that. And we're also going to try and leave as much time as we can for questions at the end, because we've got a really interesting panel up here, which the hope is it always brings a really interesting group of people to the event. And from the reception, I know that is already true. So we definitely want to get a sense from you all about some of the things that you're thinking of in this space. So we're going to start it off with just a few minutes of an overview of U.S. and constitutional law. A very brief. This is going to be like a whirlwind trip from Linda. And so that I'll turn it over to Linda.
So I'm just going to do the very nutshell version that I think is relevant for our conversation today. Obviously, we have a First Amendment, which I've been spending a lot of time thinking about, especially recently with Occupy in general, but Occupy Oakland in particular. And a couple of key aspects of the doctrine. I'm not sure exactly what the audience is, but I understand it's somewhat mixed. So I apologize if some of the things I'm saying are a bit remedial. One of the key critical components before the First Amendment applies is that there has to be state action. So the First Amendment only protects our speech when the government tries to limit our speech. A key other aspect of the First Amendment, there are obviously many, many complicated doctrines, but the basic, one of the important sort of overall gist is that the level of protection for your speech depends on the nature of the property where you're speaking. So in general, it has to be government property, but depending on whether it's what's called a public forum or a non-public forum, then the government has more or less latitude to regulate what you say. A public forum is something like a street, a park, a sidewalk, those spaces that for time immemorial have been open to public debate, so-called speaker's corner. In those places, the public's interest in free speech is at its highest, and the government has the least latitude to regulate our speech. So it cannot regulate your speech if it's trying to target the content of what you're saying, except in very unusual circumstances, and it can only impose what are called reasonable time, place, or manner restrictions. In other kinds of government-owned property, what are called non-public fora, like an administrative office building, the government has a lot more latitude to regulate speech. And so it can impose what are called reasonable regulations, which translated into English means anything goes. And the only real limitation is it cannot engage in sort of viewpoint discrimination. So if you're, you know, this has come up a lot, say when I speak to students at UC who are protesting fee increases, if they're protesting on Sproul Hall, that's in Sproul Plaza, that's going to be a public forum, and their speech rights are going to be at their greatest. If they're going to the University of California Office of the President's administrative building in downtown Oakland, that's going to be an administrative building, and their ability to go in and leaflet or picket or handbill in the lobby is going to be very, very limited. And really the only limitation on what UC can do to keep out protesters in a non-public fora is if they engage in viewpoint discrimination. So they wouldn't be able to allow pro-fee increase protesters but exclude the anti-fee increase protesters. So one of the things that I think is also relevant for the purposes of this discussion on the public forum doctrine is that it is, there are limitations, there are some very conceptual circularity problems with the public forum doctrine, because the test for how you determine whether property is a public forum where speech has more protection or a non-public forum is somewhat circular. It depends on the purpose of the government's purpose in creating the property. So if the government intended this to be a big and public open space, then it gets to be a public forum. But of course, you're typically not in court suing the government unless they didn't want to let you have a speech. So if it's totally determined by the government's intent, that's not a very robust view. That's not a very robust approach to speech rights. Anyway, there has been a lot of criticism about the public forum doctrine and the sort of circularity of it, but that is the doctrine that we live with. Sort of key things for the purposes of this discussion, I think, again, federal First Amendment only applies when there's state action, and then also you have this sort of limited notion of what constitutes a public forum as determined by the government's purpose. The real crisis that I see in the future of free speech, because one of the things I'm best at is worrying, is that increasingly, as the title of our program is, increasingly we're having conversations less on the town square, the traditional public forum, but on on privately owned platforms. So all of our protections in the Constitution for limitation, censoring our speech, regulating our speech, are simply inapplicable. The conversations that the government could not censor if I had it on Sproul Plaza or at Justin Herman Plaza or at Civic Center Plaza can be censored if I'm having it on Facebook or Twitter and those corporations decide to change their approach to free speech. Perhaps all hope is not lost, because I think one thing that people often forget is that California actually has a state constitution too, and it's extremely robust and very interesting. There are two things that about the state constitution where the doctrine is much more robust than the federal First Amendment. One is on this notion of what constitutes a public forum. I sort of trashed in a nutshell what I think are the flaws with the federal public forum doctrine, that it's very circular. But the state doctrine is, instead of looking to the government's purpose in order to determine whether something is a public forum, looks to what's called, it's a more functional test. It's called the basic incompatibility test. And it looks to whether the nature of the property is actually compatible with speech, rather than looking to what the government wanted to do with the property. So you have these two remarkable Court of Appeal cases that would have come out totally the other way under the federal doctrine. One was a case where people were trying to leaflet in a parking lot at a prison. Now, under the federal public forum test, no court would have found that to be a public forum. But the Court of Appeal said, well, look at the basic, is this place sort of basically compatible with free speech? And yeah, you can stand up in the parking lot and leaflet, and that's not a problem, so go let them leaflet. Another case that was quite remarkable under the state constitution involved the visitor center at, get this, a weapons lab. So this was the Lawrence Livermore Weapons Lab, and they had this lovely visitor center where you could look at, like, you know, the history of the nuclear bomb. And there was this anti-nuclear group that wanted to have their leaflets in the weapons lab. Not surprisingly, the weapons lab said no. But the Court of Appeals said, well, it's a visitor center. It's about ideas and information, and so, yeah, let them have the leaflets. So again, this would never have come out the same way under the federal test, but it's an example of where the state constitution is much, much more robust than the federal. And the other key area, which we won't really address because Phil will have much more insights into this than I will, is the state action requirement. Under the state constitution, California has found a privately owned shopping mall to be subject to free speech restrictions. And so, this result would never have happened under the federal constitution. But there are exciting ways in which the state constitution provides much more robust protections that perhaps can be useful for us as we shift our conversations from the public square to privately owned platforms. The only other thing that I wanted to kind of just end with is that, you know, we're talking about how the premise of what I said, this crisis in free speech, is based on this idea that increasingly we're not having our conversations on the public square, but instead on privately owned platforms. The last 2 months with Occupy Wall Street has turned that paradigm on its head. So right now we're seeing a much more robust interplay of conversations on the physical town square, but also interacting in really fascinating ways with conversations that are simultaneously happening on all kinds of private platforms, but they're also then generative of physical conversations on the town square. So I think that's just a fascinating footnote to that. So that's my nutshell version of the First Amendment.
Thank you, Linda. And so that sort of brings us to Phil and your story of Pruneyard. And wanted you to sort of share with the audience some of the historical context of the Pruneyard case and the state of the law and the factual situation and where we are now and where we hopefully will be going in the future.
Well, the story of the Pruneyard, Temple Emmanuel in San Jose, the Reformed Jewish congregation that my family has been members of since way before I was born, is celebrating its 150th anniversary, and a handful of past presidents of the congregation were asked to come and give a talk on anything interesting that happened while we were president. And so I used that occasion, that invitation, last month to tell the story of the Pruneyard to the congregation. And almost none of them were around in 1974 when the whole thing started, but it was in a pretty mundane way. Having served the two previous years, 72 and 73, as I think the youngest ever president of the board, the bylaws said you stay on an extra year as president of the executive, chair of the executive committee. So when the board meeting was over, we held an executive session, as we did, to see if there were anything come up. Well, the junior youth group had a little delegation that came to talk to the board about a legal problem. And the legal problem was, in very simple terms, they'd gone to downtown San Jose with a petition that was their project, a petition addressed to President Gerald Ford. Would you please use your good offices, Mr. President, to go to the UN and ask them to change, to rescind their recently passed resolution that said Zionism, meaning in that context, meaning a support of Israel, is a form of racism. That was a resolution that had been passed. And they'd gone to downtown San Jose with this petition, couldn't find anybody. There was no, at that particular time, because of the rise of the first shopping centers in our area, and I've taken the speech that I gave last month, and I've got an article that I've submitted for publication to the California Lawyer, and there's copies of it out there that tells this whole story. But and tells you why there were no people on the streets of San Jose at that time, but that was the case. And so one of them had the idea: let's go out to the Pruneyard. It was the closest one, and they did. One of the two leaders was the assistant rabbi's son. One was the religious school principal's son. So they're nice, well-scrubbed little guys. They were all, the whole half dozen of them were 14. And they went out to the Pruneyard. They set up a card table in the center court, and people were coming over and signing their petitions. Some of them, and some of them were walking away, but they were polite. But not 10 minutes went by when a security person came over and said, "You're going to have to leave." And they did. They didn't make a fuss about it. They left. And they came to the temple board to fix it. And what happens in those situations, for those of you who are lawyers, every head in the room turned, you know, to face the one lawyer in the room, and that was me. I'm not a constitutional lawyer, although, as Michelle mentioned, I had my first job with the Civil Rights Commission, and my passion has always been constitutional law, but I'm a divorce lawyer. And But I said, I had a great answer for them. I said, I went to high school with the leasing manager at the Pringyard, and I'll call Kevin, and he'll fix it. I'll tell him what nice kids these are, which I did the next day, and he thought it sounded like a great idea, but he had to call the owner, and so he called me back at the end of the next day and said, the owner feels that if I let these nice kids do this, I'll have to let everybody do it, and so the answer is no. So at that point, it was the first time that I actually had to crack a law book and read what the law might be, and it was at that time pretty similar at both levels of courts, both the federal and the state, but within the past decade prior to 1974, each of the courts had come to a conclusion that in a large regional shopping center, there was no expressive right. But Justice Stanley Mosk had written a dissent in the California case, Diamond versus Bland, in which he talked as if he knew what the role of shopping centers is in a place like this. And he said that shopping centers were the functional equivalent of the town square in much of California society, much of California commerce. So I'd also observed, and it was just I was observing politics at that time because I've always had an interest in that the court composition had changed, and this was the era in which Rose Byrd had become our Chief Justice, and the other appointments by the youngest person ever to sit as governor of California, Edmund G. Brown Jr., had appointed three new justices by that time, I think it was, since Diamond versus Bland, and it looked as if there was a very real possibility that the court might change because of the position of the Mosk dissent. That's the importance of dissent. We learned that in law school, that it's often not futile to write a passionate disagreement with the majority. And so I asked the board at the next meeting for authorization to file. The other thing I looked at was the federal court and its composition, and it just didn't look as if there was a bit of a chance, in part due to the history of, excuse me, the First Amendment litigation and how it had come to the point it was with the Lloyd Center case out of Portland, Oregon, and they had firmly held no First Amendment right, but Justice Mosk was telling us that it's not an open and shut matter just because the Supreme Court rule is one thing. For the civil liberties and civil rights of citizens of the several states, and that's what's called federalism, and so individual states can interpret rights more broadly, not more narrowly, but more broadly than is available to all the citizens of the whole country. So I explained all that to the board, and one of the things that I still chuckle about is that I had as tough a time convincing that board of trustees to go ahead with this thing as anything that happened in the next 6 years. all the way, the same questions came up from these small shop owners, and a very conservative engineer. We had lots of those. Harold Newman, I remember his name, and he hammered me with these very difficult questions about the nature of private property. Doesn't it include the right to exclude people from your property? And And so I had to answer him satisfactorily enough that I could get a majority, and they did. The board authorized, because the reason I needed their authorization is that the senior partner of my firm at that time said it was okay for me to handle it on a pro bono basis, no fees, but we needed to get our costs covered. The cost of depositions and transcripts. It was going to be a few thousand, you know, maybe a few thousand dollars, but nothing very great. And so I was asking for the temple to take responsibility for out-of-pocket costs, and that's why this debate. And so they did, and they authorized it. And the one other thing that was kind of, well, lots of interesting things, but we had a trial, and that was important, that we had an evidentiary basis to all this. The leader, Mike Robbins, the son of the assistant rabbi, was the first named plaintiff, and I put him on the witness stand to just tell what the project was. And the only other witness I had was a marketing professor from San Jose State who had done an actual survey of where retail sales occurred in our community. And at that time, he was able to demonstrate that almost none of it occurred on the public streets. The great majority of it occurred in large regional shopping centers. And so from that, one could infer that if you want to find people to sign a petition, if you want the right of petition to mean anything, you had to be able to go to the shopping centers. And as Stanley Moss told us, they are the functional equivalent in our society of the public forum. So we filed in Superior Court, had this hearing. Judge rules against us because of Diamond versus Bland. Go to the Court of Appeal. The three judges rule against us because of Diamond versus Bland. But go to the California Supreme Court, and that's when the court did, by a 4-3 vote, overrule Diamond versus Bland on the ground that our Constitution makes special mention of the right of petition, and they recognized what the importance of large regional shopping centers was in our society, and came down that way. But there was a vigorous 3 on the other side. By George, we'd won. Yay! Go home. Let's go out to the printing yard and get those. Let's get those petitions signed. It's now 5 years later. The shopping center industry urged the prune yard to file a request to the United States Supreme Court to hear the case. And at that point, I think a conflict of interest that I have never experienced any other time. I mean, God, I'm just dying to go to the United States Supreme Court and argue a case like this. But my duty is to my client, and so I have to write this response to the petition and tell the U.S. Supreme Court that this is a local matter. Supreme Court shouldn't care a whit about it. It's a penny ante case out of, just involving some 14-year-old kids, and you know, you've got more important things to do, folks. We'll see you some other time. But the response to that was really, it was like a little postcard that came and said that they had granted jurisdiction and would be hearing the case. And so I figure at that point that we were sunk. We were just sunk. We were the victory that we had achieved 4-3. Had been taken. Why else would the Supreme Court take the case other than to sock us in the jaw and take it away from us? But the rest is published history. I'll just say a couple more things about the subsequent litigation that has occurred. The court said in the Pruneyard case that this right to expressive conduct on privately owned property would be subject to reasonable regulation of time, place, and manner. And so I, for the first few years, I would get calls from various people from all over the state. They want to have us produce a $1 million insurance policy to assure that nobody would get hurt as a result of what we're going to do. Well, I expressed the opinion at that point that that was not a reasonable regulation of time, place, and manner, and that if they wanted, and cases of that kind were easily resolved. I don't think there were any that maybe you know that went up on that that kind of issue. And then, but the two big cases that have gone back to the California Supreme Court were the one in 2001 involving the Golden Gateway apartment building, and the tenants' union had wanted to circulate petitions there, and. Now it's 22 years later than the state court, and the court split, but did sustain the principle of the Pruneyard. But they did make it clear that as Linda was explaining, that you had to have property that was public in its nature, and they said that while the Pruneyard is very important, a good law, that it doesn't extend this far, and so didn't do that. And then the other one that came up was in 2007, the Fashion Plaza down in San Diego, a great big old shopping center down there. And there was a question of, I guess they're called secondary boycotts, where it was an effort was underway to boycott one or more of the stores that were located in the place itself. And the court there, by a 4-3 vote, it was faced with, is Pruneyard still good law? And the court held 4-3 that it was, that it is still good law. But boy, they said some nasty things in the dissent. You should read it, about my case. The history has not blessed the Pruneyard. The majority rule in Pruneyard, said the dissenters, Justice Chin, I think it was. Cited other states that had experimented with it. Well, a few of them had done what California had done, but other states had gone the other way. And I've concluded that the Pruneyard rule is something that needs to be defended if you believe in it. But there's just we need, if we're going to have a right to address our government with grievances, we have to find some place other than the public streets to do it, and go to places like the Pruneyard.
So fast forward 20 years. So, 20 years ago, this speech had moved from downtown San Jose to the shopping center. That's where the people were. And fast forward 20 years, Occupy notwithstanding, the people have gone online, there were recent reports in the 2008 campaign that, close to 50% of people are using the internet for political speech, that half of young voters are using social networking, that 800 million people are on Facebook, with a third of them being in the United States, and many people searching online, watching videos online, many on Google. And so sort of fast forwarding 20 years, Dorothy, you work on the transparency reports about sort of government demands, about censorship and takedown, and coming from the public streets to the private shopping centers to the online world. Sure, what's the scope of the problem? What are the issues that we're seeing with speech moving online and sort of the tension with censorship and control on the private platforms?
So at Google, what we like to do is really start with the numbers. So I'll give a big picture stat, and then I'll drill down from there. The Open Net Initiative estimates that in 2002, we had around four governments censoring the internet in one way or another. That number has grown to more than 40, and some people even estimate 60 governments in less than 10 years. And so the way we're getting there isn't always about the usual suspects. That's what we're seeing. And it's really interesting because sometimes governments are creating laws and policies that are creating effects that they didn't intend. We're seeing a lot of collateral damage. So we have a very limited scope at Google, and I'll be really honest about that. We receive government requests to remove content and also for user data, but we are not the only company that receives these requests. We are one of many, many technology and communications companies that sees this. So the observations I'm gonna give are about, you know, purely our platforms and this limited view. But our transparency report, what it does is, if you look at it, there's two different features. The first is called traffic. And what the traffic report does is shows the availability of about 20 services in different countries around the world. And so you can choose a particular country, a particular service, and you can actually see a graph of normalized traffic around the world. So what you'll basically see is when people wake up, they start to go online, start to use our services. When they go to sleep, the number drops down, and so you have this nice curve. And then once in a while, what you'll see is this drop-off. And what does that drop-off mean? And so the trend that we're seeing with traffic is sometimes it's governments that are more repressive and therefore don't even submit requests to us because they're basically just cutting off our services on their own when they're not happy with what's on there. And we actually saw the most significant trend, which we didn't anticipate, and was when the Egyptian government cut off internet access in January for a total of 5 days. And what the trend that you see there is quite interesting. It's about a single point of failure. All the internet traffic in Egypt runs through a building called the Ramses Exchange. And so all President Mubarak at that time had to do was call the Ramses Exchange and tell him to turn off the power. And he was basically able to cut off the entire internet. We also see this in some other interesting settings. One of the really funny trends we saw was suddenly we saw access to our services in Armenia and Georgia cut off for 5 hours earlier this year, or like half a day actually. And so when we went back to see what actually happened, we saw several news stories pop up the next day, and it was actually an 80-year-old woman who was scavenging for copper who happened to cut through a cord that carried all the traffic into a neighboring country. And so you have the issue again of a single point of failure. That's one trend that we see. Another one is the idea of when governments turn access on and off. What does that actually mean? It's gone way beyond is giving access is great because everybody can express themselves. You'll see that recently after Gaddafi was toppled, Libya turned on access to our services. You will also see the same thing for Syria in February. And it's actually, we say it's indicative of, you know, the tumultuous Arab Spring. But there's a lot of speculation around Syria and why they actually turn on access to our services, particularly YouTube, also Facebook and Twitter at the same time. A lot of people are saying it's because the government was using those services to spy on users. And so you see that elements of surveillance start to play in, and that's a trend that we also see as well, and that we're having actually some trouble detecting, and we would love help in that arena. The other feature on the transparency report is called government requests, and this is what Nikki was referring to. So requests both for user data and also for removal of content from our services. For content removals, we actually break the requests down into reasons for removal. So you'll see things like defamation, you'll see things like privacy and security, national security, and in some cases, government criticism as well. And what we see is the reflection of the laws that are being created around the world and how they're being enforced. And it's actually quite fascinating. In this past cycle, we were just updated with a six-month period of requests, so January to June. We actually got some requests from the U.S., different local law enforcement agencies from the U.S. that asked us to remove videos from YouTube of police brutality. Now, uploading those videos is not illegal, so we did not take those videos down, and we actually refused this request. But when the media started reporting on it, we actually saw them start to reference Occupy. Now, there's a time lag. Obviously, Occupy was a phenomenon that happened fairly recently compared to our data set, which is from January to June earlier this year. But it does signal the impact of the different requests that are coming in and what platforms actually have as their responsibility when it comes to upholding free speech. Will we take it down just because a law enforcement agency asks us to? Or are we going to actually take the time and effort to go through the request and see if it actually cites a relevant law and actually push back on the request and have to deal with the government relations aspect that goes along with that? We also see some overbroad laws with collateral damage coming through that I was talking about. Something we've been fighting a lot is the recent legislation, SOPA, in the United States Congress. But around the world, we're actually seeing a lot of interesting ways that these numbers are being used. In India, in the first half of this year, we were actually asked to remove a number of communities from a social network we had that's only popular in India and Brazil for some reason, and it's called Orkut, and we can't figure out why. But regardless of that, the communities were asked to be removed because they violated a law about religious content and inciting religious hatred, and also happened to criticize a local politician. And so what was interesting about that was about 2 months ago, there was an amendment to India's IT Act that was being considered in Parliament. And the idea would actually force companies like Google to monitor our users and also force them to adopt standard terms of service across all our services. And a very, very young Indian MP of the opposition party, opposition to the majority, actually stood up and said, if you look at the numbers in Google's transparency report and the annotations, you'll see that, you know, a lot of the requests we're making are quite frivolous. And this actually violates the spirit of the IT Act, which was put in place to protect intermediaries. And so it was really interesting to see our numbers being cited in that context. It's also interesting to see the different numbers and what that reflects. So in Brazil, there are certain laws that prohibit parodies of candidates and also certain kind of comical criticisms of candidates being uploaded to the internet or posted on the internet in any way. And so you'll see that around the electoral season, we have a huge number of requests from Brazil that come specifically only from electoral courts that are particular to enforcing that particular law. So what we say usually about transparency is that it's important to have these mechanisms in place so that citizens can and policymakers alike can actually see the effects of the laws that they're creating. Are they actually enhancing or are they eroding freedoms online? I think that's the critical question that we ask ourselves and ask citizens to consider when we put numbers out in the transparency report.
Well, so now that we've had a little lay of the legal land and the experiences of Google, I'm going to put Lawrence on the spot, since you deal with a lot of different companies in sort of at every stage of their development. And, you know, what are some of the, you know, Dorothy intimated at some of it that, you know, they're a platform, they have some interest in speech, but there's also sort of the other side of that. And what are some of the competing interests that you see affecting companies that are platforms, and how are they addressing these in their terms of use, in their policies, and are they thinking about these things as they're developing, or is it just sort of all of a sudden they have some kids in their platform and they have to figure out what to do?
They think about it from the beginning. But first, I've got to say that Phil's case and the Pruneyard case was probably one of the reasons that I ended up in California instead of Georgia. Because if you're in Georgia, you don't think of the shopping mall as a marketplace of ideas. But in California, you were able to make that happen. And back when I was in law school, this was actually a recent case. And it was, so, you know, we've got at least three generations here probably by now. It was really exciting, and I think it's exciting to talk about it now down the line. We represent lots of companies. The business of business is business, and the first drivers for all these companies is sort of thinking about what they need to do to be successful as a business, as an enterprise. And so there are a lot of companies, and Google's one of the best ones, that actually care about speech, and that want to do the right thing and actually want as a motto or an objective to try to make sure that speech is open. In Google's case, that's also very profitable. For others, I think less so. And I think that the businesses that we're dealing with, from startups to end ups, are very conscious about what they're trying to do with their site, what they're trying to do with their platform, across a real broad potential spectrum. And they're thinking about this in terms of what I think of as sort of two basic risk areas. One is public opinion risk or public relations risk, and the other is legal risk. So the public risk, where we start is we start talking with businesses about what they want their business to be. What is it that they're offering people? What's their product? What people do they want to attract? What do they want people to be able to say? What is the tone? Setting the tone at the outset is critical for whatever business it is to become successful. And the tones vary because there is such a broad range of what people want to offer on the internet. Somewhere between staid and sleazy, somewhere between button down and barefoot is where people want to position themselves. And so we ask our clients at the beginning, do you want to be a place where you can take your mother? And there are a lot of platforms, a lot of websites where, you know, you really don't want your mom there. She's not going to be very comfortable. And that's what those websites want to be. And that's fine. And we will help them become that kind of a website. And it will be a very freewheeling, free-speaking, open place. And then there will be the Ladies' Home Journal, which is going to have a much different policy about what comments happen on their sites, what blogs they put up. We have a client called DeviantArt.com. You can imagine how speech happens there. It's a huge site. There are 180 million pieces of art posted by 18 million people on that website.
Is that DeviantArt two words or?
It's one, dot com. And then
just,
you know, you have websites that are going to make it safe for you to be on the internet because people won't be able to find out what you're doing. And so those people have their own motives in this situation. So two, I think, pillars in or place marks in the spectrum are probably Apple and Google if you think about their apps from the get-go. So Apple. These are value judgments that these companies have made. Apple gets complaints about the shaking baby app. You guys remember that one? You shake the baby in the app, the baby dies. There were so many complaints about that they took it off. Apple got complaints about an app that was up from Exodus International, which is the gay recovery organization that's going to help you un-gay your friends. And Apple took that one down. Because of popular uproar, and they didn't want them around. And that's the way they run their platform. It is something where every app's reviewed and every app's decided upon, and that's their value judgment, and the world may be better because those apps aren't there if you are of that mindset. In the Google world, there was an app, Is My Son Gay? Do you guys know that one? Where you put in the information if you want to figure this out, you know, and the app will tell you. It's sophisticated gaydar. And the Google didn't take it down despite the uproar that came out. Another one that the government came and pressured Google to take down the DUI site. That would tell you the DUI test points or breathalyzers that you were coming up to. That's gone off of Apple, I think, but I don't think Google's folded on that. So you know, there are big differences in the way people, companies, organizations are thinking about what's happening on the internet. And I think another example, I think, of where that happens in a big context was Amazon, where after they deleted all the copies of 1984 off of people's Kindles, there's a huge uproar. You're a censor. You're getting into my stuff. And so they have to recalibrate the way that they think about user rights and expression and what they're going to do. So that's the public opinion promotional sort of risk. The other risk that's a driver is legal risk. Are you going to get sued, and how much is it going to cost? Are you going to get investigated, and what's it going to mean to you? So we know the kinds of things that pose those sorts of risks. One major one is IP, where you can get sued for copyright infringement, trademark infringement. You can get sued for having someone else's trade secrets on your site, maybe, depending on what the CDA means. And so that is a situation where the owner or claimant to the content is able essentially to do the censorship. We'll talk about SOPA more later, I'm sure. Then you have the non-IP types of pressures. Will you get sued for defamation, for invasion of privacy? Will you get sued for harassment or for other sorts of tortious activities? Those are pretty well protected and aren't nearly as much of a pressure point legally because of the Communication Decency Act and the immunity that it gives to the hosting of speech that others make on your website. So users that speak on your website and say bad things about other people, as long as they're not infringing intellectual property, do not expose you to liability because you are protected by the CDA exemption. So these risks apply to everybody from Google to DeviantArt, but I think the other key takeaway here is that it matters a lot where you are in your life cycle, how you're going to respond to these pressures in a number of ways. One is resources, but the first is when you're in the startup mode, when you're first trying to organize the site, the main thing you want to do is survive to the next level of funding or to the next level of user base. And so what you want to do is stay alive and not get sued. And you can't afford big lit any more than you can afford big law. So you're trying to play a conservative. If somebody tells you that you shouldn't be saying something or allowing people to say it, you ain't going to say it because you can't afford to fight it. You get to the point when you're somewhere in the mid-range and you've got some users on your site now, and the users are actually becoming a much more significant asset to you than the code. You need to keep those people, you need to keep them happy. And so when you get to that middle point, you're actually starting to think much more about how am I going to protect these people, how am I going to make them happy, and what do they want? If you alienate them, they leave. If you put on oppressive policies, if you take back things that they want, you see what happens, whether you're Netflix changing the terms of your deal or whether you're Facebook changing the terms of who owns stuff. So you have to really start to protect your users. And so most people, once they get a user base, are willing to defend the rights of those users to speak and start to move towards a place where they will push back, invest, litigate if they need to. I think by the time that Twitter got the subpoenas that they got from the government about WikiLeaks, they were probably past little into, well, probably somewhere from middle heading to big. That was the beginning of this year. And Twitter was at the point that they would push back. And they said, we're not going to give you the WikiLeaks communications. You're going to have to go. We're going to give all the people who were involved in those communications notice so they can fight it. Would they have done that their first year? They probably couldn't. And then you get to the big stage, and then you're Google, and then you have huge resources and a business model premised on free speech and expression, and you will fight, and you will push for the rights of users, and you will, in fact, try to do impact litigation about that, because that's where you are and what you need to protect your business model. Now, you can also be Apple and be big and sue people for disclosing advanced versions of, iPhone designs. Big does bring power, and it brings, options, and for some, they're used precisely to protect free speech. And if you think about how big Google is and how much money and resources it has and how pervasive and everywhere it is, you're getting to a a level that's quasi public. You must be able to be on Google if you want to reach the world. And that's because Google has been successful in letting everybody speak so that they can catalog it.
So, I mean, that's a perfect segue to bringing Andrew into this conversation. And
sorry, I didn't mean to.
No, it is a perfect.
How dare you?
And one of the questions, of course, is the people have moved from the public square to the shopping center. They've moved from the shopping center to the online space. The online spaces have become big. They're where all the people are. They're where all the much of the speech is happening. But, you know, what there are a lot of similarities that we've talked about sort of moving into the and it becoming sort of an essential forum. But there are also some differences related to the internet. There are nuances between the physical space and speech online. And, you know, how is the internet different? What are, you know, related to sort of where speech happens and, you know, what standards are used for speech? There's a lot, it's a bigger world out there. And as Dorothy mentioned, there's a lot of different competing laws and interests that are at play with one internet, but many nations. So Andrew.
So here we get to kind of like the nub of the conversation. So Phil started off telling the story about how people had moved from the city center out to the shopping malls, from places that were essentially publicly owned to places that were privately owned, and sort of how the California Supreme Court and the federal courts would have viewed that question differently based on the different constitutional provisions that that apply. And so so now we see this other shift from the pre-internet world into the internet world where, you know, increasing amounts of human activity and commerce and political dialogue and so forth are happening online. And so what's important about the sort of architecture of the internet, I guess, is that it's a fundamentally private set of networks that are voluntarily interconnected, that basically all speak the same common protocols. TCP/IP, is kind of the most notable one, but it's just a whole bunch of private networks that agree to share data with each other using a common format. And so, so the question then is, like, so, you know, can we learn anything from public forum doctrine, and would we want to impose any pruneyard style obligations, for example, on the places where the speech is happening? So that's the question. So a first question then is, like, sort of where is speech happening? You know, like, what does it mean to be a public forum, or to be a forum for public conversation on the internet? And there are a lot of different ways that you can answer that question. So speech might happen anywhere that a server is located that receives the packets that constitute a communication and hosts them for transmission to anybody who wants to read them. So in that sense, you would look at the machines of the internet and say that the places where the data comes to rest, essentially, for some appreciable period of time, that's a location. You might also say that wherever the speaker is located is the place where the speech is happening. You could say that the destination of the reader is the place where the speech is happening. And in different contexts, different courts in different countries have adopted different points of view about this. We just earlier today did my last class of my comparative free speech class here at Stanford, and one of the questions that we were looking at were the different jurisdictional tests that are used in particular in the U.S. and in Commonwealth countries. And this arises most often in the context of defamation and libel, right? So the standard U.S. test, which applies basically as a matter of civil procedure across the U.S. to determine which state's law applies, is what's known as a targeting test. So in other words, you say to a court will ask, you know, was the speaker targeting Alabama? And if so, then you can expect that Alabama courts will exercise jurisdiction and apply Alabama law. But it's the idea that you are purposefully availing yourself somehow of Alabama as a jurisdiction, and so it's fair to apply Alabama law. So even if the New York Times is published out of New York City, If they're selling advertising and delivering copies of the newspaper into Alabama, then it's fair to apply Alabama law. Commonwealth countries, meaning the UK and Australia and Canada in particular, have all applied a foreseeability test. And they've basically said, basically it's foreseeable that anything published on the internet is accessible anywhere on the planet, and so it's always foreseeable, and therefore that it'll be read there, and that it'll harm the reputations of the individuals you're writing about there, and therefore, basically, everything on the internet is subject to every country's jurisdiction all over the place. And that's the test that they apply. It's a foreseeability test, and they've been quite dismissive of that. So anyway, so this is an example of where we have sort of differing views about what it means to be a public forum for a particular set of individuals. So anyway, turning back to the U.S. context, because that's the most important one, we have this idea that an infrastructure supports and sustains public dialogue and public speech. And the infrastructure is privately owned by the Googles of the world. And frankly, the governmentally owned fora are totally non-existent in this world, right? So it is the case that the White House has like a comments forum, but as a location for kind of the great debates of the day, it's essentially irrelevant. What really matters is Facebook and YouTube, in much more localized context, often public forums that are hosted by like newspapers and websites that serve particular industries or particular communities of interest. Anyway, that's where these conversations sort of happen. And to me, what's sort of interesting about this is that the problem of private entities controlling these spaces and setting the terms and the limits of the debate is more a problem in theory than it is in practice. In other words, YouTube, for example, has fairly aggressive rules about content. There are large segments of speech that they just simply exclude as a matter of corporate policy. And Lawrence was outlining some of the ways in which, in the context of the App Store, you have an Apple approach, which is to be highly restrictive and to keep offensive and obnoxious things out, and a Google Android approach, which is to kind of let everything which is not literally a worm or a virus go, with very few restrictions on the basis of substance or content. And so you can look at that and say, wow, it's great, like there's always at least one place where you can go. But if you're an iPhone owner, you can only get apps off of the Apple iPhone store, and so you really are subject to this set of corporate policies. And so to me, in sort of one way of looking at this problem, you have a whole captive audience of tens of millions of iPhone owners that are subject to the corporate policies of one company for the content of the applications that they can get. You can take a broad view and say, well, okay, fine, but they've opted into a controlled environment, just like I can opt not to go to a shopping center and can only, can do a lot on my by my own volition to avoid serendipitous contact with points of view that I don't agree with. I don't have to go to the shopping center either. Or you can say, you can sort of look at it very broadly and say, well, the apps market online is only one way in which people can encounter speech. There's the vast panoply of all the websites of the world, and all of these different channels that transmit over the TCP/IP interconnected networks of the world. And so, broadly speaking, the internet, I think by any measure, creates this massive surplus of speech and contact and dialogue. It's when you drill down into particular narrow verticals, like iPhone users getting speech via downloadable apps, that you really encounter these corporate policies as constrictions on the broad ability of individuals to engage in speech and dialogue. Just one concluding sort of thought, which is, I do think it's quite notable that corporate policies seem to basically fall into two broad buckets. One is the community bucket, and the other is the neutral platform bucket. So the community bucket says, we want our site to be, as Lawrence said, friendly to your mother, or another, you might say, a place where people feel safe and included, and where the provider of the platform or the service wants you to feel welcomed and have a positive experience. And then you have the sort of like neutral platform category, which is sort of like anything goes. It's a free speech, free for all. We don't want to get involved in editorial decision making of any kind. So Google search engine is an example of that. Blogger is an example of that on the Google world. And we've seen this kind of like yo-yoing back and forth of what the sort of dominant zones of human human dialogue on the internet, where they take place. At the moment, the YouTubes and Facebooks seem to be significantly more important with their much more restrictive rules and their much heavier corporate hand. But we've seen this yo-yo go back and forth a couple of times, or this pendulum swing back and forth a couple of times already. And I think it's entirely plausible that the bloggers and Tumblrs and the more wide open free speech actors will take market share and become even a more compelling place for people to interact with each other, or at least to be a significant part of the global dialogue around politics and culture and education and all the other things that people talk about online. So anyway, that's sort of what it looks like to me online. I have to say that we always have to flag the practical problem, which is that any effort to try to either vindicate public dialogue objectives on private internet platforms through affirmative obligations or negative limitations runs into the practical problem that it's very hard to figure out how to do that in practice without doing tremendous violence to the flexibility, dynamism, and rapid iterative capabilities of the internet to develop and deploy new services rapidly. It's very hard to figure out how you can avoid sort of libertarian gotcha, which is to say the kneecapping of the thing which makes the internet so special and so powerful by virtue of the application of rules that run counter to that.
Well, before I have the panelists, before I ask them a concluding question, I can't believe we're already out of time, but I want to make sure that we have enough time for questions from the audience. But I just wanted to get a sense from the audience. You know, we've talked a little bit about, and we've tried to touch on the fact, you know, our online platform, such an essential forum, that like in the Pruneyard context, there should be an obligation that they're open for speech, you know, absent reasonable, you know, with reasonable accommodation. So I just wanted to get a pulse from the audience. Folks out there, do you think that online forums like Facebook and Google have become essential forums, and it's important for these Pruneyard principles to be extended there? Or are you more comfortable with this sort of curated experience where you go to a site and it may have speech, it may not have speech, you may have to go somewhere else? So who votes Pruneyard in here? And my mom votes the other site, so. All right, well, I just wanted to get a sense of
But what was, I mean, we haven't raised this question, though, which is like, what does Pruneyard mean in the online context, right? So, I mean, you can't ask the question that you just asked without talking about what that actually means. Pruneyard, to me, and maybe you can, you know, correct me if I get this wrong, but to me, Pruneyard in the offline context means there are some places that are so public that we're going to say, subject to reasonable time, place, and manner restrictions, petitioners, at least, but maybe speakers more broadly of matters of public interest, can go and avail themselves of that forum as a place to encounter people and present them with speech or ask for their involvement in an act of expression. Online, what would it mean to say to the Apple Store, you must accept any petitioner subject to reasonable time, manner, and place restrictions through the App Store? I don't even know, as a practical matter, what that would look like. How would we even give shape to that kind of a principle in an App Store? Like, we're going to say you cannot exclude racist speech. I can't imagine this Supreme Court in California or in Washington saying, we will require you to take all speech, I'm sorry, anything less than all speech in that kind of a context. In other words, if you declared a public forum subject to Pruneyard responsibilities, would you really say that Apple has to permit anti-Semitic, you know, racist, or other kinds of abusive speech given their business objective to have like sort of a safe and inclusive environment where people actually want to show up, there's no constitutional way that the state could give them that out to say you must allow, you know, in a sort of Michael Johnian fashion, you must allow speech about democratic self-government or politics, but we're going to allow you to exclude other kinds of speech. There's just no way that the government could do a less than whole hog kind of mandate.
So I think one way to think through those questions, and I think those are exactly the right questions to ask, is can we borrow from existing doctrine? Like in the First Amendment context, we have these tests about when something is a public forum and when something is a non-public forum where there's less speech, less of a speech interest. I'm not thrilled about applying the federal public forum sort of model onto it, because I think that test is totally circular, and it depends on if the only time you would ever be able to leverage the doctrine would be if Twitter suddenly goes bad, but you would never be able to impose it on Apple because, and maybe we shouldn't, but I'm just saying, you know, how this would work. You'd never be able to impose it on Apple because Apple would say, well, our purpose is not to do this, our purpose is to curate. If you look to another approach would be this state constitutional basic incompatibility test. And I should fess up that at the ACLU, we always say, this is the state doctrine. To be clear, it's two Court of Appeals decisions. The California Supreme Court has not rejected it, but has also not accepted it. And it is actually the best articulation of the state constitutional basic incompatibility test is to be found in Ninth Circuit opinions. So that's a little irony. But if you take a sort of basic incompatibility model, then the question is this forum inherently conducive to the free exchange of ideas? One of the projects we have at the ACLU is actually to sort of expand the litigation, the good cases under the state constitutional doctrine. We brought a case in the city of Reading, which imposed these very bizarre anti-leafleting restrictions in the plaza in front of its public library. And I thought that was a really exciting case to bring, because if you look at it from a federal perspective, what's the purpose of the plaza? Ingress and egress to the library. If you look at it from a state constitutional doctrine, you get this, what's the purpose of a library? The free exchange of ideas. The purpose of the plaza is to facilitate the space in front of the library that it's dedicated to the free exchange of ideas. So we brought this case in state court under the state constitutional doctrine, got a fantastic preliminary injunction talking about, oh, it's all about the free exchange of ideas. This must be a public forum. And we're happily on the way to the Court of Appeal now, so I'm hoping to get more case law on that. So if you apply that model to private platforms, there's a different way of thinking about it. I think the very, very difficult question is the one you raised, which is what are the countervailing free speech rights of the platform? So if you are, again, just to take it to a sort of bricks and mortar analogy, Prune Yard, you know, that shopping mall is, we don't think that there's necessarily an imprimatur that we have to worry about for the compelled speech perspective, because that shopping mall was not really engaged in anything but, you know, providing a space for various commercial transactions. If we're looking at Revolution Books in Berkeley and we're saying, you know what, you need to sell this book as well as that book, then that looks like a huge First Amendment infringement on the bookseller's right to curate the sort of collection of books that they want to sell. So I think even if you apply very expansive kind of public forum doctrine, like the state basic incompatibility test, as I would like to see it interpreted, to the internet, you still have to give sufficient breathing room to the First Amendment interests of the platform if they want to be an Apple and actively curate, then I think there's a good First Amendment defense there.
Yeah, you know what's interesting about that is that raises the very practical reality that by statute, Congress has given platforms an incentive to be non-curatorial, neutral actors, which is to say this remnant Section 230 of the Communications Decency Act is the one that says that there is no liability for the content on a platform so long as you're not engaged in the editorial selection or editing of the content. That alone has proven to be a very powerful incentive to these platforms to do as little of that as possible. What's interesting to me about sites like Facebook is that they are, in fact, very actively engaged in this editorial process. Even YouTube and some of the Google properties do it as well. Apple does it in their App Store. And they do it because they've found as a matter of kind of like community dynamics that, you know, significant exposure of users to like racist, sexist, hateful, whatever kinds of speech really turns them on and makes them flee. And so I have to say on a personal level, though I'm like pretty hardcore, and I was when I was designing some of these policies at Google, on the free speech side, there are these services where it really is quite, you know, noticeable what happens when the site gets overrun with speech that people find to be obnoxious. And there's this very kind of, I think, I'm very sympathetic to the interest of some of these social networks and other platforms that are trying to exclude that kind of speech. And what I would worry about in the application of a Prunyard style incompatibility test is that I can't find a good way to distinguish between, let's say, Blogger, which is, you know, basically just a publishing platform that's pretty neutral and doesn't do any editorial control, and something like Facebook, because they're both clearly places where this kind of conversation and dialogue is taking place, but the application of a full kind of like Prunyard time, manner, and place restrictions only approach to Facebook would, I think, turn it into a place that really kind of like withers over time because of how negative people might find it to be, just given the internet behavior of kind of like massive flame wars that, you know, sort of, you know, are kind of fun to read, but when they infect your wall, you know, kind of turn you off.
So there's some interesting contrasts between what's happening in terms of the censorship that Prunyard did versus what's happening on the internet. And the first, I think, is that in the Prunyard case, it was all neutral. You just couldn't be pro or con Zionism at Prunyard. They wouldn't let you say anything. And that's not what's happening on the internet. The internet restrictions are primarily content-based. Facebook doesn't want you saying things. They don't want you bullying. They don't want you calling names. And so it, in some ways, that is a more insidious sort of limitation on free speech than the Prunyard situation had. Second big difference is, in Prunyard, if you spoke there, you were known. You were not anonymous. Now, leaving Facebook out of it, there are many places where on the internet you're completely anonymous and unaccountable. Mm. In Prunyard, if while you were leafleting, you trashed the wall with graffiti or did whatever else was destructive, you were held accountable for it and you had some limitations on your behavior. There is none in many places that you operate on the internet. And so the anonymity of speech, I think if you said to a provider of a platform on the internet, you will allow people to say anything and they can say it anonymously. I mean, you're opening up far greater risk than allowing people to come in the Prunyard context. And the third distinction is this, and that is just scale. And it's interesting, the Prunyard decision talks about two things. First, it says that the right of free speech did apply to a place where 25,000 people were induced to congregate daily to take advantage of the numerous amenities offered by the shopping center. 25,000 is a lot. Okay, so I mean, we're on, you know, 2-3 sets of zeros, higher than that. And yet we're not saying that places that have locked in 25 million app users have any sort of restriction on them. On the flip side is, that opinion said, a handful of additional orderly persons soliciting signatures and distributing handbills under reasonable regulations won't interfere with the normal business operations. And wouldn't markedly dilute the defendant's property rights. So, you know, they're looking at 5 or 6 people going into a place of 25,000, and the scale of the internet is so much more vast that you have to wonder how you apply that kind of rationale.
And I think that, you know, this panel, as you can see, is sort of the beginning of this conversation, certainly not the end of this conversation. And one of the questions is, you know, where do we see free speech online in 5 years, in 10 years, in 20 years, kind of looking back as we're looking back at Prunyard? And I do want to leave a couple minutes if folks have questions, if you want to line up here. But while we're waiting, you know, quick response. Do people think there'll be more or less free speech online in 5 years?
It does seem likely in a litigious society like we have that the cases are going to come up in one way or another, and so the fact that you've undertaken a project like this to take a first cut at trying to see whether there are parameters that can be, you looked at me as if I might know more than any, I know less by a lot of zeros than you do because I'm a Luddite. But I recognize the importance, and I recognize that the society, the marketplace of ideas, is just one of many things about life as it was in 1980 that isn't in any way the same as it used to be. And so we need a project like this to go forward, and at least to try to gel civil libertarian thinking about what we do to preserve a real marketplace of ideas, a pluralistic society. To me, that's the word for the future. As long as we have a real exchange of ideas, the marketplace will do its job. I don't know. It hasn't been tested with all those zeros yet, but I have faith. So please take this forward.
Can I just say one thing, which is, you know, just to what Lawrence was saying, you know, one thing that I think is interesting is you're right that the, like, Facebook rules and the YouTube rules are content-based. They are, however, viewpoint-neutral. I mean, I was trying to think if I could think of any that are not viewpoint-neutral. In other words, in the language of the Supreme Court, they're not pro or they don't single out, you know, pro-abortion, anti-abortion messages. They,
you know, a little Siri yeah. flap today.
Oh, I did read about that. Yeah, so Siri apparently is the...
She, however, has a point of view.
Yeah, has a point of view, that's right.
Viagra, okay, abortion, no.
Right, but they do. But they have what they have are viewpoint-neutral categorical exclusions that are generally have to do with some either sense of harm, in other words, it's like bullying speech or something which people would find sort of abusive or alienating, or is something that... is kind of like categorically offensive to, you know, significant numbers of people. So, but I don't know that lets them off the hook in any way, that they sort of like get a buy just because they're viewpoint neutral within the vertical categories that they're excluding. But it is interesting to me that like it's a peculiar, you know, sort of feature of these sets of rules that they try to make people feel like kind of like have a positive experience. And I think what's interesting is if I were really motivated, a really motivated like pro-life activist, let's say, and I felt that the way to persuade people of my point of view was to do like very graphic, you know, visuals or something like that, and I found that they were getting taken down, it does seem like that's a problem from the perspective of public discourse. In other words, if the places where everybody's doing their speech are excluding the most persuasive version of the point I'm trying to convey about public policy, that does seem like that's sort of an issue. And
well, what was Skokie other than Nazis? And yet you can't be a Nazi on many sites now. And you call it viewpoint neutral, and I'm just not sure anybody can define neutrality when it comes to ideas.
Yeah, I think
and viewpoint neutrality is not, I mean, that's a pretty extreme end. I mean, it's the content-based regulation that's very troubling. And then these very broad categories of categorically offensive. I mean, Lawrence raises the point exactly. I mean, the First Amendment is there to protect minority unpopular views.
Right, and back at the time of Pruneyard, you know, it was considered that supporting Zionism was racism, you know, that was racist. So it's like the discretion of we don't want to allow racist, we don't want to allow sexist, that can actually, in history, change a lot of conversations. So, Mitchell.
Yeah. I was the attorney in the other of the two California cases, so I think we have California law covered in its entirety. And I, you know, my sort of...
For the audience, why don't you, but what was the name?
The UC Weapons, Nuclear Weapons Lab Conversion Project versus Lawrence Livermore Lab, where actually the outcome was even more radical than you explained. What the injunction allowed the opposition organization to put their leaflets in unused leaflet racks at the visitor center and to put up 2 3-foot by 5-foot placards in places in the walls they weren't using and to use their slideshow once a month. So it was that last one, there was some viewpoint neutrality thing going on. But the other two were very much an example of the kind of the speech orientation that said, people go into the visitor center occasionally. If you want to affect, it's a center for communication. If you want to communicate with them effectively, you can't make people have to stand around 24 hours a day for, you know, every day to do it. So it was kind of a push. What I wanted to say, though, was that I think there's another line of federal cases. Maybe they've all been superseded since the Livermore case. But there's federal law on this tension between private and private property and speech may be more nuanced, where there are more openings in it. I mean, we relied, and I'm sure the Pruneyard did also, there's a line of federal Supreme Court cases involving company towns. Mm-hmm. So these were like small towns owned in their entirety by a company. And in these 1940s cases, the Supreme Court held that, you know, the fact that the company owns the entire town, the streets, the homes, and everything else in it, can't really be interpreted to mean they can exclude, in that case, Jehovah's Witnesses from going door-to-door proselytizing. And there are, I think the cases on public forums are not as sharply divided. There's a body of cases, and I think Livermore case fell into that category, of what were referred to some time ago as semi-public forums. So the prison parking lot, the waiting room in a welfare office, where people were, I think in federal cases, allowed to quietly go around and talk to people about the welfare rights organization. So I'm not sure like the law on all that is that sharply. If the government decides it's got a purpose of not allowing speech, no speech. So
I agree. I think it's not as dismal as that.
Yeah. So I think even the federal cases also there's an opening for that. And I guess in applying this to the internet, I think it's like Lawrence's point, I think is an important one. And I think Pruneyard does not stand for the principle that every piece of private property can now be used for speech. And I think that like the tough thing is not a matter of sheer numbers, but numbers along with the character of the site and the role that it is playing socially. I think those are relevant considerations. And I think if you have literally hundreds of millions of people using Facebook as a means of communicating with each other, that I think there's a serious question about whether Facebook private property rights can allow it totally to control the use of that site for speech. I don't know exactly how to implement that. I wouldn't say
we'll give you a call.
The court is likely to.
We'll give you a call.
But it's disturbing, and that disturbingness is partly enforced by its users' expectations more than law. And those are I'm not sure I have the same expectation that every app or offensive ones will be allowed, you know, in the App Store. Then I do an expectation that in a place that is a site that is devoted to nothing but pretty much speech and communication among people, it's totally in the unfettered control of a corporation.
This is a question for Dorothy. I was wondering with the Google policy of free speech, do you draw a line? Is there a certain content that you do take down? What's that line?
Yeah, that's a good question. I think Andrew kind of addressed this as well since he helped write a lot of those policies. but basically, we have There's two different types of ways that content is regulated on our platforms, and the first is we are subject to about 200 different sets of local laws in countries where we operate. The second is what the panel was referring to as, you know, our terms of service. So we do have different terms of service that govern content on each of our different platforms. They are slightly different depending on the type of platform. So you'll see Search and Blogger, like Andrew was saying, for example, having a very neutral set of policies that basically allow, you know, many types of content. And that's particularly to the United States, where we have protections under CDA 230. When you go to a different country where we don't have those protections and we can be liable for that content, it's a very, very, very different situation. Then we have YouTube, where we have, you know, a set of community guidelines that are far more restrictive than you will find on Search or Blogger. And then you have ads, which is a platform where we basically make our money, and so we have even more restrictive set of content regulations there. They are slightly different. What we do try to do on YouTube, which I kind of find in the middle of those two different extremes, actually, is we're trying to balance free expression with our responsibility to maintain a safe community. And so what we do there is, you know, for certain types of graphic material, we'll age restrict it. So we'll require you to log in and sign in. And to do that, you have to provide, you know, date of birth or age or that sort of thing. And then, but we may bend those guidelines once in a while for news value or for scientific value. So you might remember in 2009 when the Iran protests were happening and when Ned El-Sultan was shot, we actually kept that video up online, even though it was very graphically disturbing. So we have, it's reasonable people disagree, I think, about what content is appropriate and what's not. I think that the key to that there's two parts when you talk about user rights on our platforms. One, our business depends on user trust. Our business fundamentally depends on users trusting us to give them the content they want. And that actually derives from more transparency, more accountability. We have to be open about what our policies are when we're taking down content and why we're taking it down, so that users can decide, do I actually want to still be a part of this community or not? They have that choice. And the important thing is to empower them to have the choice to leave if they want to leave. And if they want to leave, take their information with them so that they can use another service. That's the critical thing. But we actually do have that service, and that's one of the projects I also work on as well, being able to take out your data from our services and go somewhere else if you want to. And that's the market idea coming into play. We have that, we provide that functionality not necessarily because we want tons of users to leave our service, but because we believe that if they have that choice, it holds us accountable to giving users what they want.
How often does that happen, though?
How often do users take their data?
Yeah.
I actually don't know the specifics of that off the top of my head. But I do know that we allow them that functionality and the ability to do that. It would be an interesting statistic to get. I don't know how often that happens.
So can I ask you a question of Lawrence and Linda? This is like maybe a provocation more than anything else. But so I was trying to, you know, so one of the things that I think gets complicated on these online platforms, in trying to think about what a prune yard, you know, sort of responsibility would look like, is that sometimes the substantive categorical exclusions are not the result of discomfort or fear of user reaction, but rather a pure business decision about basically like how to spend the company's resources. So in other words, mm-hmm. Blogger for a long time was hosting sexually explicit speech, porn basically, and they realized that like because Blogger's free and a free consumer service, commercial porn services were basically just offloading hosting content costs onto Blogger. Mm-hmm. And so they just said, you know what, we just have this much money to spend on infrastructure, we're just gonna take this off because it's vastly disproportionately burdening our servers. And there are some other categories that are like that too, which is basically like if you're in the business of providing free hosting services, you have to decide like you have, you know, $100 to spend on your infrastructure, like what do you want to support? And so that's one of the ways in which I think it sort of gets complicated. Like we've talked about the community rationale, which is basically like the substance of certain kinds of speech scares people away. And then there's literally a kind of like cost offloading sort of rationale.
I feel like there are a million ways to do that. So if I were like constitutional law god, I mean, you could borrow from different existing models. So for instance, I always end up reverting to labor law metaphors because that's where I came from. But for example, if you know, you can't discriminate against employees because of their right to organize, which means that you cannot shut down your plant if the goal in doing so is to squelch a union organizing campaign. However, if your goal in moving the plant is a purely business decision unrelated to a desire to squelch the speech, then you can go ahead and do it. So there are ways you could do,
yeah,
you could import some kind of analysis.
Pretext analysis. Like pretext analysis is hard to do.
You right? could have an intent test, you could have a disparate impact test. I mean, there are all sorts of ways to do it so that you still preserve the ability of the business enterprise to engage in legitimate non-speech suppressive activity. And you can, you know, formulate the standard intent, effect, you know.
What do you think about community, like, as a reason to exclude categories of speech?
So that's interesting, because then you can have a sort of, like, Boy Scouts mm-hmm. associational interest, right? So, like, the right of intimate association. Mm-hmm. If you want to band together on a particular social networking site that is specifically catered to evangelical Christians, yeah, I think it would be extremely problematic.
Would you withhold from Facebook or YouTube the ability to say, generally, we want to just have a positive community vibe, and therefore we're going to exclude these, you know, minority points of view on, you know, the sort of racist, et cetera, you know, points of view.
Like, so I feel uncomfortable with that. Intuitively, it strikes me as Big Brother-ish.
What if you could show that users flee? Right? Like, what if in other words, this is what I struggle with. In other words, if Facebook can show demonstrably that a surge in racist speech causes people to ditch their service, like, because I get the constitutional reasons why that's, you know, why, you know, from a constitutional perspective, the right answer here is like, well, there should be more speech and people should counter it, mm-hmm. non-racist speech or whatever. But again, strictly from the perspective of like a business trying to run a service, it strikes me as pretty hard to argue with what I think is a pretty consistent experience online, which is that kind of, you know, sort of like hate speech, exclusionary speech, bullying speech, and so forth, literally kills your business. Like, it just sends people running.
And again, I think there are ways to construct the standard so that what if even you can have a speech promoting standard that also pays sufficient heed to legitimate business interests, but it has to be a legitimate business interest, not a made up one, because the danger you often see is like, oh, bullying. I mean, I deal with tons of school cases where there's so much concern legitimately about cyberbullying in some very extreme cases, but then, you know, recently I had, you know, a sophomore who called her volleyball coach a pussy on Twitter and was kicked off of the volleyball team all in the name of cyberbullying. So you have these overly elastic definitions of what is offensive speech that really dumb down the debate in very unhelpful ways for our democracy.
Mm. So there's a lot to talk about in this issue, as you can see. So I want to be respectful of time. Hopefully the panelists can stay up here maybe for a couple more minutes for those questions that we weren't able to take. But I really want to thank everyone for coming. I certainly want to thank the panelists for being here tonight. And, you know, from throughout history, this has been an important issue. And I think we're really at a critical juncture to really start talking about this and thinking about this. So I'm excited sort of as this being a launching point of more discussions in this way, and hopefully having all of these good ideas continue to flow. So thank you very much. And for those of you, the link on the behind us is actually a link to a lot of the articles that are on the handouts. If you want to explore some of these issues further, I'd really encourage you to. And I want to thank Stanford for hosting us tonight and the State Bar of California. So thank you all so much.